Next up, we have Hyperledger Avalon introduction by Manoj. It's all yours.
Yeah, thanks, Amol. I'll just let me. I think you need to stop sharing, and I will share my screen. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so yeah, in the next 15 to 30 minutes, I'm going to give an overview of Hyperledger Avalon. So I'm Manoj, and so I'm working in as a software architect in Intel, and I'm also one of the Hyperledger Avalon maintainers. So let's move on. So the agenda is pretty short. We would see what Hyperledger Avalon is. Why is it useful with some one or two usages, and an overall architecture explaining how it works. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, so in short, so Hyperledger Avalon, it's a ledger independent implementation of a trusted compute specifications, which is actually published by Ethereum Enterprise Ethereum Alliance. So just to get to describe a brief history of this, so there was an effort going on Enterprise Ethereum Alliance, which is a consortium under Ethereum Alliance. So they were looking at improving the privacy and the performance of blockchains. Though they started with Ethereum, and as the discussion progressed and as the spec progressed, it can kind of become evident that this specification is going to be ledger independent and could be adopted by different blockchain frameworks, right? So that way, if you look at it, it's an interesting intersection of Hyperledger and Ethereum Enterprise Alliance, because though the spec took shape in Enterprise Ethereum Alliance, the reference implementation of the spec, which is now known as Hyperledger Avalon, is part of Hyperledger umbrella. Okay, so what Hyperledger Avalon does is it helps to securely move some of the blockchain processing which we typically is done on the main chain to an off-chain components to some kind of dedicated computing resources which will be running off-chain, right? And this would enable a couple of things like improved blockchain throughput and scalability. It also helps to improve the transaction privacy, and also helps in use cases like attested oracles, right? So oracles are, it's like the trusted reporters of data, which is kind of generated outside the blockchain and then fed into the blockchain. So these are some of the advantages of using Hyperledger Avalon, because it provides you a framework to do off-chain transactions in a secure manner. And if you look at it, it is like one of the broadly sponsored projects under Hyperledger. We have almost like 16 sponsors for this project right now. So it's, for any standards, pretty vast and broadly sponsored projects. And and again, it's to give some more history of this. So this started as an Hyperledger Labs project, Avalon, and it was initially forked off of another Hyperledger Labs project known as Private Data Objects, right? And Hyperledger Labs project, as many of you know, is a place to facilitate any kind of collaborations and experimentations among projects. And then once it got mature to some good extent, it is now a top level Hyperledger project. Okay, so let's move on, and I would explain why Hyperledger Avalon is useful with little more details. Okay, so this is a block diagram of a typical blockchain framework, which has three nodes. And now if you actually look at it, in any blockchain frameworks, since it is a decentralized solution, and to And so all this data and validation logic for every transaction that takes place on every node in the blockchain, where we also term it as on-chain execution of these transactions. But again, this redundancy and transparency is what provides this blockchain network with its integrity. But at the same time, it also comes at the cost of performance and confidentiality, right? Because performance in the sense that, hey, now the same transaction has to be executed by every node independently, right? And also this data is exposed to every other nodes. So that's what I meant by there are trade-offs on performance and confidentiality in a traditional blockchain network. But then what can you do about it, right? I mean, one option would be definitely is like we can offload some of the work, especially these transactions to some off-chain components. But then if you do that, then it would kind of, you are kind of trading off on the resiliency and integrity, right? To gain some performance and confidentiality. So the trusted computing or whatever Avalon is targeted to do. So Avalon is basically a trusted compute framework. So what trusted compute is intended to do is it is intended to maintain the resiliency and integrity guarantees, which anyway the blockchain network provides, and while affording the additional performance and confidentiality. Right. So this is what the Avalon is trying to do. So in this case, this is a traditional blockchain use case where enterprise A and enterprise B agree upon certain smart contracts, and they kind of execute the smart contracts on every node in this blockchain network. And also the transaction data is kind of visible to every blockchain participant or every node in the blockchain, right? Now let's see the off-chain execution of smart contract, which I was explaining. So here the thing is, not instead of executing all these transactions in each and every node, this would be kind of offloaded to another trusted computing resource, which is actually residing off the chain, meaning it is not part of the blockchain network. It could be something residing outside the blockchain. Now it means that we are doing some kind of the decentralization goes away, the complete decentralization goes away, but we cannot avoid doing that because that's on the first place we created blockchain because we wanted to do a decentralized network. Now to improve the performance, so what this trusted compute the component does is it does all the computing in there are many options of doing some trusted compute trusted computing for transactions. So one such option is to create a trusted execution environments. Say for example, you could create an Intel SGX or ARM Trust Zones, right? So which ensures that this data and the logic is handled in a trusted execution environment and no entities outside the TE can access those data and the logic. And again, there is a, depending on the kind of trusted execution environment that you use, there is a way to prove to the entities that, hey, this transaction has indeed executed on a TEE. And again, the blockchain is coming into picture because the blockchain will still record either the results of the transactions it might actually store the results of the transactions in an encrypted format, especially the results, the output data, or it might just, depending on the use case, we might just store the receipt that the fact that, hey, the transaction has occurred and it has happened inside a TE. So this way, every node does not need to execute the transactions repeatedly, like in a traditional blockchain. You execute these transactions in a trusted environment, and the receipts can only be stored, and the receipts can be validated by the individual nodes. So that way, this is going to help in improving the performance scalability aspect, as well as the maintaining the confidentiality of the transactions and the data that it handles, right? So that's the main advantage of using trusted execution or off-chain execution. So moving ahead, I just wanted to map that to one use case. So this is a use case of an IoT, which kind of uses some edge sensors to do some processing. So again, on the left-hand side, this is again a traditional blockchain network, where you will have a warehouse with a lot of sensors, and this sensors data might be sent to every node in the blockchain. And as you are familiar, there would be smart contracts running on every node in the blockchain, and it executes and it stores the results in the blockchain. But then this is not a pretty good option whenever it comes to scalability, because as and when more nodes are added to the blockchain, and every node has to replicate these transactions, and overall it takes a good amount of time to reach execute these transactions and reach the consensus and adds the and adding those transactions to the blocks. And again, the data is kind of seen by all the participants. Now, as opposed to that, on the right hand side, we have the trusted worker, which is an off-chain component. So in this case, all this sensor data processing is happily happening on the trusted worker, which is could be running on an edge server, for example. And this trusted worker is actually doing all this sensor, taking the sensor data and doing the calculations, and it might just store the results of these transactions on the blockchain, or just the receipts of this transaction on the blockchain. And only the nodes just has to validate from the results of the receipts that this transaction has indeed happened on a trusted execution environment, so that it kind of knows that, hey, this transaction has not been tampered with, and it has executed, and based on the smart contracts that has been agreed upon, right? So that's what the off-chain computation does for you. This is yet another example of a medical insurance use case. Let's say a business wants to get some group medical insurance for these employees, right? So in order to do that, any insurance companies would, to provide the quote, the insurance companies would need some medical data of the employees. Let's say the medical insurance companies would like to calculate the heart disease risk factor of the average heart disease risk factor for all the employees. Right now, as we all know, the medical data is a very confidential data, and we don't want to kind of share it with any parties unless we kind of ensures that all the parties who is involving in transaction ensures that this data won't be tampered with or exposed outside. And typically there could be hospitals who would be maintaining these medical records. So in this case, all this communication can happen via a blockchain network. There could be a blockchain network created between the business, the insurance companies, and the hospitals. And the business could actually authorize the hospitals to provide the medical data to the insurance company if they ask that details. But at the same time, the insurance company has to prove to the hospital that and to the business that, hey, it is going to securely, it is going to secure the medical data of the employees, and by executing the algorithms that they have and the data which the algorithm handles in a trusted execution environment. So for that, so this is a very high level flow of that, where the business can authorize the hospital to access the medical data, and it can request a quote, and all these quotes could be stored in a blockchain. The insurance companies can fetch these quotes from the blockchain, and then it can request the hospitals to provide the data, right? And this and the hospitals, of course, when it stores the data in the REST in the blockchain, it would store the medical data in the encrypted form, and also when the data is being transmitted over the network, also it will be in the encrypted form. And when the data is being used, or whenever it is in memory, since it is running on a trusted compute device which has a trusted execution environment, even the data which is being handled in the memory will also be in an encrypted form, and only the TEE can see the memory in clear, because only TEE knows the keys to decrypt those data, and whenever it places it in memory, only the TEE will have access to that memory. So there is an end-to-end protection of the data, and that at the same time there is resiliency, and also the integrity of the data is protected throughout the cycle. So this is achieved actually by executing some of the transactions off-chain inside a trusted computing resource. So that's what I want to explain about the overall advantages of Avalon. And now in the next two slides, I would just give an overall architecture of Avalon. Okay, so let's move on. I would take the questions at the end of the presentation. So please bear with me till that point. Okay, so Hyperledger Avalon, this is a high-level architecture. So basic components are, so one is a blockchain framework itself, which is this, and the blockchain framework could be, it could be any framework, it could be Fabric, Sawtooth, or any Ethereum framework, right? And then there is a client, or who is the requester. And then there is a off-chain component, which you are talking about, which is the trusted compute service. So now the requester or the client can interact with the trusted compute service. There are two options through which he can interact. So one is using the blockchain framework. So wherein the requester only talks to the blockchain framework. And in the trusted compute service, there is a component called blockchain connector. So that's the component which actually talks to a different blockchain framework. So this is the, this blockchain connector is the component which actually makes the trusted compute service able to talk to different blockchain networks, you know, be it Fabric, be it Sawtooth, or be it Ethereum. So that's the part I want to highlight here, because though the specification, the trusted compute specification started on Ethereum Enterprise Alliance, this is not limited to Ethereum Ledger. It is applicable to multiple ledgers. And this blockchain connector module is the one which is facilitating the communication across different blockchain frameworks, right? Apart from that, it also supports multiple workers, and these workers are the off-chain components. Now, these workers could be a TE worker, which I was explaining sometime before, basically the worker which executes on a trusted execution environment. Now, definitely it supports other kind of workers like zero knowledge proof workers or a multi-party compute workers, or there could be any workers of your choice, right? But the whole point here is that all these workers are, it's like a trusted compute, executing in a trusted computing environment, right? So one of the examples, the reference implementation today for Avalon, it supports a TE worker, and it supports, currently it supports Intel SGX as a TE worker, right? So there are a couple of other components which I just want to highlight. I mean, because there are, see, at the end of the day, what the requester or the blockchain does is it kind of gives some kind of work orders, right, to for the off-chain component to execute. And at the same time, the requester or the client, there is a way to, for the client also to directly interact with the trusted compute service if the use case demands it. And for that, the trusted compute service provides a HTTP REST endpoint, which and the communication happens using JSON RPC APIs for all this worker registry, work orders, and the work order processing and things like that. And it also has a work order registry, which would enable the blockchains or the clients to understand the details of those workers. This is slightly more expanded view of the diagram which I was showing, which I just showed earlier. So here where it shows the workers, and again, the orchestration here, basically it means that the workers could be typically be running on different systems, right? Because at the end of the day, this is the one which is going to provide the scalability, because a system can only handle those many workers. And if your use case demands multiple executing multiple workloads or handling different workers, you have an option to run those workers on different systems, and you could use any kind of orchestration mechanisms like Kubernetes or Docker Swarm or whatever the framework that you're familiar with to run these workers on multiple systems. And you could also maintain a work order registry, and that could be a database that you would maintain for the off-chain component. Right. That's how it kind of very high level, that's how it works. And this worker is the one which handles the multiple workloads, and workloads is what which executes the off-chain logic of the transactions. Okay, so this is pretty much what I want to cover. And so please give it a try. We have the code exposed in GitHub in Hyperledger Avalon, and that does have some good amount of examples about how you can create trusted worker and how you can submit your workloads to the trusted worker, either directly or via blockchain. You could also join the Hyperledger Avalon channel and for any of your questions. And yeah, so just give it a try and just try building some workloads and consider Avalon for your blockchain projects. Yeah, that's what I wanted to, that's all I had, and I'm ready to take any questions.
Thanks, Manoj.